ThinkTech Hawaii. Civil engagement lives here.
Hey, aloha from the ThinkTech Hawaii studios. This is Security Matters Hawaii. I am your host, Andrew Lanning, and today we're going to be talking with Lisa Bradshaw from United Technologies Corporation. She is with Linnell Systems International. She is a prominent woman in security, so we're going to start with women in security. But the first question, Lisa, I want to ask you is,
yes.
What keeps you up at night being a security professional? What goes through your mind?
Oh, gosh. Okay, so there's just a lot of different things that I think are happening in the industry that are really important. So one of the biggest things that we're dealing with now is cybersecurity. Mm. And so the biggest thing for me as a manufacturer, having a play in that and being able to be a trusted advisor and advise our customers, I just want to make sure that we're giving them good advice because they're definitely using that to secure the systems that they have, that we're selling them, right?
And that's been an issue, right? A growing issue that we've all been working on for a while. I think I lose some sleep over that one too.
Yep.
So thanks for coming in today.
I really appreciate it.
I caught you while you're out in Hawaii, so I'm really happy to have you here. Can you give our audience just a little bit, some of your background, as much as you want to share with, you know, how you evolved in the industry and then how you ended up, you know, sitting here?
Sure. So I started in the industry about 16 years ago, I guess, and I just fell into it. I went to work for a company that was doing real estate virtual tours, of all things.
Okay.
And that technology, that 360 technology, became a company called iPix.
Sure, I remember that.
That was
actually
a 360.
Sure.
Yeah, so I was one of the first employees that moved to DC when we started that division of the company to develop the 360 technology. So that was sort of my entree into the security market.
Wow. I didn't know that.
Yeah, yeah. And so I've had, you know, my family has been sort of in the industry. My dad was the sheriff where I grew up. My mom has been, she was the international 911 coordinator for a while. Yeah, she was elected to do that for a while. So it's been sort of in my blood, so
it's
to speak,
in your DNA.
But it's never really gonna do that, any of that, right? So, but when I got into it, I really loved it. And the reason I did is because of technology, I think. Because at that time, I was doing megapixel and no one else was, right? So it was very interesting. And since then, I have to say, it hasn't been a gap in technology evolving, and I think that's the biggest thing that sort of kept me in it, right? And so one of the main reasons that I came to Linnell after being sort of on the camera and the video management side is the solution side of it, which we've been talking about the integration of different systems and all of that for a long time. And I think Linnell has done a really good job at developing those partnerships and the integrations to make systems more efficient. And I think one of the bigger things that we're talking about now is operational efficiency and business applications versus just security, right? So that's, you know, why I stay, I guess, having gotten into it about 16 years ago.
It's interesting. We talk a lot about no one grows up wanting to be in the security industry. You don't think of that. You might think, oh, I'll be a cop or a detective, but no one thinks about this. No one even know about this industry.
Well, I wanted to be a movie star.
Oh, you did?
That didn't work
you
out.
You made it today. You're here.
Right, here I am.
See? But I mean, it's just an interesting thing. And then, well, once people get in it, it's all this cool technology. It's never ending. Like, we're growing all the time.
Yep.
And then we're protecting lives and we're protecting property. So it has this, for me, a sort of a left behind factor, right? We have this factor that all the stuff we've done every day, every hour, is still protecting people when we go home.
Yep.
And I like that about it, because we could kind of work anywhere in technology. There's tons of technology.
Exactly.
But this one's special. So I love it that you are challenged to stay in it, especially with the you mentioned the platforms that Linnell has tied themselves into. And of course, UTC owns Otis. And they own carriers.
Yep.
So the building automation, well, I hope in my career I get to like automate a building someday. That's the one thing I'd like to do, because the technology is truly available now.
Well,
you know?
We have a building in Florida where we've actually done that, right? So we've taken all of the UTC technologies, partner technologies, and put them into an efficient building.
So that's something.
We actually have a place where we can take customers and make sure that they know sort of how this can be deployed and it really is a reality.
Yeah, and it's finally here. I mean, I've been chasing it for years. I was kind of wondered who'd do it, for, who'd really do it, you know?
Sure.
And you need a greenfield opportunity like that, though, where you get the chance to build the building and design it and do it right.
And I think people do pieces and parts of it.
Sure.
You know, and that was one of the things we were talking about at your seminar this past week, is there, people do have all these systems. They're not really thinking of how to tie them together, right? And so maybe one or two might be tied together, but they don't think about how they might, you know, think outside the box a little bit and think about how they might put other systems in there to drive, you know, either efficiencies or drive more security.
For sure. So. Yeah, so there's been another trend. We're challenged with technology. We've also been challenged, as have many industries, to bring recruit women into our industry.
Yeah.
So you mentioned like you've been in maybe 15 years. I think I've been in this industry maybe 25 years. And, you know, the rooms always, everybody looked like a bunch of golf balls, right? A bunch of old bald-headed ex-military guys, right? You go to the conferences. And there may be women in marketing or perhaps in accounting, but we didn't really have them in the technical areas. And so now, and you're quite technical yourself, you're a regional sales manager.
Right.
So you're talking technology to people. You're now starting to approach, you mentioned talking about cyber technology, being that trusted advisor. What's your take on that? I mean, that rising role and the changing role. The demographics are changing a bit from a gender perspective, I think, in our industry. It seems to me the rooms are, there's more women in the rooms. It's not, I don't think we have parity yet. It's not 50-50.
Yeah, and by
but
no means.
But it's open to women, I think.
Yeah, I think it is. And I think many industries have challenges, especially in the technical side, getting women involved in that. But being more male-dominated industry in general, I think there's been, you know, women in security plays a role in that. There's a lot of men involved in that as well. Mm-hmm. How do you mentor younger people to come into this industry? Mm-hmm. How do you recruit and help people stay in the industry? And so every time I walk into a room, for example, I do look. I just notice how many women are here. And what are their roles or responsibilities? I'm so interested in talking and figuring out, you know, what is your job, right?
Sure.
Because I think there are less, as you sort of go up the ladder, there are less and less women sort of rising to the occasion, so to speak. And I hate to even think, like, I'm motivated. I don't like to even think about the fact that there's, you know, any other reason other than our own effort, right?
Of course.
Right. And so I think that's, you know, we're all working really hard to get to the C-suite and be the CISOs and all that. And more women are becoming that. And I think as more women become involved in those types of roles, there'll be more adoption in the corporate as a whole, because women bring something unique and different to that C-suite, right? A different way of thinking, a different way of collaborating. And I just don't think that there's enough people that sort of embrace that yet. So I think once that we promote that, I think people will begin to see that there's a whole lot of benefit to having sort of this, you know, synergy between how men think and what they do and how women think and what they do to build on how an organization is run and how people are treated and all that.
And hopefully how our industries run even, you know.
Yeah, definitely.
It's an industry that needs collaboration. I mean, every room you go in, and if FBI is talking, DHS is talking, NSA is talking, our industry's talking, everyone says we can't do this alone. We've got to work with our communities. We've got to work with all the stakeholders.
Yep.
So I have to agree with you. I happen to work, you know, my wife runs our company. I work for her. And her style of leadership is far more collaborative than my own. I was Navy trained.
Yeah.
We laugh about that a lot. Unfortunately, I've had trouble adopting a more collaborative mode of leadership, but she does it very well. And it's fun to watch and fun to learn from, and a constant challenge for someone like me who just wants to give you your marching orders. Like, I've done that 50 times. I know how to do it. Not giving the other person the opportunity to perhaps do it a better way.
Sure.
Or even another way, whatever. It doesn't matter. But I'm too quick to do that, where Christine's not. And I noticed that when I work with other groups of women in the industry, that there's a sense of openness to their approach that didn't come from the Navy, I guarantee you that.
Right.
We were used to getting orders barked at us and then barking orders downstream, you know, and it was expediency was the given reason, right? If you don't do what you're told, people die. But, you know, and I think in business can be a little softer. It doesn't have to be run the way the military's run.
But, and there's some good parts to that, too. I mean, you figure out sort sort of how to get things done quick and go get them. You just don't want to bulldoze and run over people to get it done, right?
So,
so I do think that the women, I think that the women, you know, the women in security and men in security and just this whole sort of idea of how do we have a good experience at work and create those, you know, whatever is a good life in that, you know, our work and our play becomes one and the same in a lot of cases. We work really hard,
right? You sure hope that you have the passion that makes it fun,
yeah,
your work.
And so
I agree.
There's the other aspect of that, too, I think, is sort of the younger people mentoring millennials, so to speak, in that we're all learning how to deal with, you know, millennials coming in. The fact of the matter is we're forced to, we have to, because they are the next generation of workforce, right? And so it isn't, you know, you kind of equate that to women in security versus millennials coming into security, in that we just have to make it work and figure out how do we promote and keep people in general in their roles and allow them to sort of evolve and make the right choices and sort of move our industry forward.
Sure.
And that we embrace all of those things, and there's no way we couldn't be successful in it because everybody has their own ideas. And so to that collaborative point, that's sort of the space that I come from, is how do you leverage other people's strengths, maybe identifying your own weaknesses and build your team based on that fact, right? And then you've created something that is unstoppable.
That's awesome. I know that Christine started the local ASIS chapter, which is the American Society for Industrial Security, has a women in security group, a council that they started, I think maybe a decade or so ago, but the group here, when she got involved with ASIS here, there was just no focus on it at all. So she's been able, I think, to recruit maybe 10 women just in Honolulu alone that are security directors or working in those roles around town that probably didn't have a voice or didn't have an opportunity for mentorship, didn't have an opportunity to get involved with ASIS and learn, probably didn't even know about it till she reached out to them. And so, you know, this is a thing we've got to nurture, you know?
Well, the Bay Area where I live, there's a women in security group that gets together, and I've gone to a few of those.
Awesome.
And there was a pretty good turnout for that, more so. I mean, it sort of stopped and started, and it's, you know, back to being pretty strong. And, you know, men come too. It's not just a woman thing, right? But I do think that there's a lot that they can promote, you know, as far as training goes and having conversations around, you know, what are some of the things that we might be experiencing and how do we overcome, you know, some of those, whether it's, you know, just not being taken seriously or whatever the case is.
Yeah,
right?
Christine's had that. We've been talking with it's happened with customers. It's happened with other manufacturers. We'll be in a booth together at a show. And they're talking to me, and she's the president, and they're like ignoring her, and she'll be like, "That guy thinks I'm your secretary." Like, you know, when we walk away, and it's so sad. Like, you know, because I've got the bald head, I'm the target. Like, you know, there's the president guy. You know, he's not doing his job. You know, what I'm saying? He's just so there can be a I don't know if it's a rigidity, if it's a I think of some of this, and even like the C-suites and a lot of those guys. It's time to just move on. And let the rest of the world take over. Whether it's millennials, women, it doesn't really matter. We stay in too long in the workforce, maybe. You know, we need that fresh blood to come up and lead.
It is an awareness thing, and I think most, if maybe people just don't think of that, right? It's like just I'm focused on you because I usually work with men, and maybe it's uncomfortable. I don't know, but it is sort of that individual, and I've experienced it myself, right?
I bet.
Sort of like it's just automatic. So I'm not blaming, but it's like, quit being so automatic about it. And it's also on us, right? So I did talk with someone about this recently, and it was sort of the same sort of conversation, but it was going into a meeting with, you know, a couple of people, and the man was the one who was being sort of directed to the whole time, when the woman was really had the ownership.
The decision maker.
Well, she probably should have made that pretty clear, right? So there's some ownership on ours as well.
Where she didn't speak up.
To make sure to speak up when we need to. But yeah, I think it's interesting because that does happen a lot.
Okay, we're going to pay a few bills because we have to do that. We will be back in about 1 minute. Thank you.
Hello, I'm Cynthia Lee Sinclair. I have a show called Finding Respect in the Chaos. It's all about women's rights and gender equality. It's a place for survivors of abuse to come on and tell their stories, and a place for advocates to come on and share important resources so that people can get past the abuse and into the hope and healing that's on the other side. I hope you'll join me every other Friday at 3 o'clock for Finding Respect in the Chaos. I'm Cynthia Lee Sinclair on ThinkTechHawaii.com.
I'm Jay Fidel, ThinkTech. ThinkTech loves energy. I'm the host of Mina, Marco, and Me, which is Mina Morita, former chair of the PUC, former legislator, and Energy Dynamics, a consulting organization in energy. Marco Mangelsdorf is the CEO of Provision Solar in Hilo. Every 2 weeks, we talk about energy, everything about energy. Come around and watch us. We're on at noon on Mondays, every 2 weeks on ThinkTech. Aloha.
Hey, aloha, and welcome back to Security Matters Hawaii. I am talking with Lisa Bradshaw from United Technologies, and we're getting ready to talk about our favorite topic, Lanil. We had a symposium earlier this week.
Yep.
We got to show some of Lanil's new bells and whistles to quite a turnout of people. Sorry if you missed that, but you can catch up here a little bit. So you run the Western region along with your partner Rich. You guys have the Northwest.
We actually have the Bay Area.
Oh, they have the Bay Area.
Northern California, okay. Northern Nevada, Hawaii.
Yeah. Yeah. So you have big customers, the big boys, right? So
Silicon Valley customers.
And Lanil's a global sort of product, has an enterprise level. It's not uncommon for us to have customers from around the world that are maybe headquartered in your area. So you get to see a glimpse of a market space that we don't really have in Hawaii much of. We have smaller enterprises, but not that global audience. So anyway, what's exciting for your audience? What's exciting for you? What's going on with the new release?
I've only been with Lanil for a couple of years, but it's been an amazing couple of years, and I get the benefit of working with people who have been with Lanil for 15, 70, 20 years, right?
Isn't that something?
So I came in at a great time because Lanil had sort of revamped their APIs and rewrote sort of the whole interface of Lanil to be in preparation for the cloud, right?
Sure.
So a couple of things that happened in that regard, right? So we've got web-based clients now, so you're not having to load software on a bunch of clients. It's web-based. So what that gives you is sort of ease of use and ease of deployment. And those are some of the biggest things that we're looking at is how do we make it easier for our customers? Mm. There's still a lot of work that goes into developing a system, right? It's complicated,
sure.
Potentially, especially in those enterprise level kind of customers. But what the company has done has been very diligent about creating the Lanil experience in a modern architecture. It's in HTML5, so that it's basically browser agnostic, device agnostic. You can use your iPad, you can use your phone, which is amazing. Mm. What comes with that is the user experience. So we have a team of people that are experts in not only user interface, but user experience. How are people using the system? How do we make it easier, more intuitive for them? Because nobody wants to sit and read a manual, right? People just want to get on and use it.
For sure. Swipe and tap, right?
So Lanil is there. That's what we're doing now, is creating these web interfaces so that people's jobs become easier to do and more intuitive.
Sure.
So that is the most exciting thing, I think, that we've been, from my opinion, been doing. And now it's just done, right?
Yeah, and if our audience doesn't know, so if you're not an access control person, or you haven't used some of these larger products like a Lanil or a Software House or a Hirsch, the thick client experience, it was necessary. There's so much technology behind that user interface, and you know, hundreds of thousands, infinite actually, configurable alarms and configurable ways to do this and that with a door or a person or an object in the system. And the ability to manipulate it took a lot of software on the front end. And so those of us that have evolved with it over the years look at where we are today, and it's like, it's actually easy to use now. Really, I remember teaching people Lanil, and literally it just took days. You know, it was really difficult.
Yeah.
And you've reviewed how to do a thing for them, make a schedule or something, and then they got it, and then they don't do it again for a year. They can't even find where to get to, you know, and it was really difficult. So today, all that stuff's gotten quite a bit simpler. And how's the reception? I mean, you're out, Lanell's doing road shows, and you guys do, you visit a lot of offices and show off the technology. How's the reception for your, like, existing users?
Yeah, I know, it's been great. So even at ISC, you know, our it was my second one with Lanell, and the booth was crazy. It was constantly busy. A lot of existing customers coming in to see what was new. You obviously had new potential customers too, but yeah, there it's a great reception, and I think that's one of the reasons that we're doing our road show as well around the country. And ours is on June 19th in San Francisco. If people want to come,
if I'm going,
you should come. Is to show people what's new, right? So people may be, we've got a lot of customers that, you know, since, you know, I don't know if I want to get into the details of what versioning and all of that, but basically, you know, as people upgrade, they get more functionality, more of the thin capability, and coming out in 7.5 that's coming out, most everything will be in this, you know, for users is in thin client architecture, the web-based stuff. There's still some thick client stuff from a setup perspective, but the users themselves, the response has been amazing. I mean, it's sort of, it's the modern, it's the thought process. There's a lot of conversation about cloud. Everybody's talking about it, saying, yes, I want to go. We have initiatives to be all cloud-based. Well, what does that mean? Like, we talk to people about what that means, and they don't really know yet what that means.
Everyone's still trying to figure out that.
But we're supporting it. We're supporting.
But everyone's going there, so.
Yep. So we support. We have what's called infrastructure in the cloud now, which is all of your, you know, your servers and everything are can be virtualized or off-prem, so in a data center.
Sure, in Azure or,
exactly.
or Amazon or Google or whatever, sure.
Exactly, and we support that. We're just, you know, the difference between infrastructure cloud and SaaS-based software as a service is we're not pushing updates to that. I mean, the integrator and the end user are still responsible for making sure that whatever their software and their updates are all happening sort of on your timeline. But certainly there are plans to have a software as a service platform and offering.
Yeah, I know our lab, our engineers that run our lab are putting that, we use Azure, so we're putting our lab version in Azure. So
and we have our demo version all on that too.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
we have a great integration with Milestone from a video perspective.
Yes.
We've done a lot of development and co-developing with them. And so we can show that in our demos. All of our everything that we do basically we can do through the cloud.
Isn't that nice?
That's set up. Yeah, it's cool.
And that's what the end users get too, right?
Yeah, exactly.
So it really works for everyone.
Yep.
And it's been, you know, we talked cloud for a while, and there's been a few products that they've launched in the cloud. There's some, you know, our industry's finally paying attention and catching on. And I think behind that, sort of the managed services model from an integrator perspective, is another thing that we've got to, as integrators, have to take on. And then, because the customers want to consume us as a service.
Well, and that's sort of where we're developing sort of this, you know, how are people going to procure a product going forward?
Sure.
Is it, you know, capital expenditures, people want to use their capital funding, and then some people want to use operational funding. We've got to figure out how to manage that, right? So subscription-based product is certainly something that we will have in the future. That subscription, you know, is going to coincide with whatever kind of service contracts the integrator might have, which makes it easy for them to pay for that kind of thing. But I think we're still figuring out, you know, how are we going to help different types of customers that want to buy differently depending on how they're getting funding.
Yeah, and sure, and like because we service, you know, federal government, we service municipal government, and then we have our contracted and then, you know, direct customers as well in the commercial space. And so, and they are all different types of consumers.
Yes.
You know, government is talking cloud, which is awesome, and they're moving stuff to cloud, but no one's asking us about consuming security from a cloud perspective yet. So that one, that piece, and even the way it gets contracted, I don't know how they'll work that out, but hopefully they will. And I think the commercial side, though, is a little more interesting and a little closer to evolving there. And I know there are some large customers, you know, enterprise level customers that are moving parts of their stuff. So they get maybe hybrid now. They got a whole corporate building that's got its own stuff, but that satellites are cloud based and things like that. So we may have a version of models for a while that we have to sort of wade through and, you know, figure out how to manage and things like that.
Definitely. So that the the great thing is as we start having these conversations, you know, we have solutions to be able to help people, you know, in that hybrid sort of scenario, and then helping them as long as we're at the table to be able to have a conversation about what you want to do, we can help, you know, architect those systems so that it's not going to cost them a bunch of money someday because they didn't, you know, think ahead or whatever, sort of like the proprietary conversation of, you know, the past.
We can fix that today.
Today
we're future-proof them a little.
Exactly.
Is so what else, you know what's pretty, I think, interesting in the readers, the Blue Diamond readers, So a lot of people are interested in mobile. I know the hotels are playing, the campuses are playing. What are you seeing there in that space?
So lots of interest in mobile credentials, using your phone as the device to be able to get into your office, also being able to, you know, integrate that into maybe another portal that a company might have that is where the employees might go, right?
Like another form of authentication.
Yeah, or just they want to use it and they want to be able to buy lunch,
Their,
so all of these things, people are just using their phones, obviously, for more. I mean, I was talking the other day to somebody and it was like they were doing something on their phone and were looking for their phone at the same time because they wanted to do something on it, right? So there were all these different concepts of I use my phone to make calls, I use my phone to search the internet, I use my phone to, you know, do all these other things, and so just having a moment, they're talking on the phone looking for their phone because they want to do something else. And so,
wait, let me find my phone. No, just, you're talking on it.
The realization that, you're talking on it.
Wow.
And I guess that's probably somebody that was over 40, but I digress. It is something that is coming. I think that it is still something that corporations, large corporations that are ingrained in sort of their cards and being able to identify people by their card.
Yeah, and I'm a fan of that. I like to know, you know, that you belong here at a glance.
It's a bit of a paradigm shift for people, right? So people are starting to get used to it. I think where we're finding quite a bit of you know, success and interest is in education, lots of students. And then also in just greenfield opportunities where they don't have anything yet, right? They don't have, you know, readers on the door already and cards and credentials. So they're interested in sort of leapfrogging into that type of technology just because it's easier. People don't forget their phones.
Yeah, the path of entry is pretty simple.
Yeah.
So we have whipped through another episode awful quickly. I would say that those folks that want to carry that badge, remember, you can still use your phone and print that little 10-cent piece of plastic instead of that $5 piece of plastic. That's going to close us up for this episode of Security Matters Hawaii. I want to thank you for visiting with us, Lisa. Thank you for coming out today.
Thank you.
I really
My
appreciate
pleasure.
It.
Yeah.
And next time you're in town, hopefully I can get you back on for another update.
Thank you.
Stay safe out there over the weekend, everybody, because security matters. Thank you.